You know, this is the first time that we have met since JD's death. And the stories have been going around at lunch hour, and they'll be going around for a long, long time. And we'll remember JD with a lot of laughter, a lot of joy. For you who were not at the funeral, it was a hoot. It just really was. People just shared stories. In fact, George had a story what was that, George?
You know, JD and I were friends for 42 years. We were friends. And JD loved to pick on me. All of his articles every year down through the years, he picked on me. He loved to pick on me. One time I had on a pair of multicolored cowboy boots, Bill. They were black, but they had little streaks of orange and gold and maroon running through them, and I thought they were the toughest thing I'd ever seen. So the first night I wore them, we happened to be working with the stamps. J.D. walked in, looked down at my boots, and said, "Hey, George, how long did the doctor say you had to wear those?" That was him, and I miss him.
One of my favorite stories of J.D., and he tells it on himself, back in, I guess it was the early 60s, late 50s, we were down in either Savannah or Augusta, Georgia, singing. And in those days, they didn't have, for you kids, they didn't have those paper machines. They had newspaper boys, kids on the street. And this little boy got after J.D. He was going to sell him paper. He said, "Please, mister, buy paper." J.D. said, "Get away, kid." And he followed him. He said, "Please, mister, please buy paper." He said, "Get away, kid." And after about two blocks, finally that kid said, "Please, mister, buy. I just got four or five buy paper." J.D. said, "I can't read." That kid said, "Well, buy it and roll it up and stick it in your pocket and you won't look so dumb." J.D. said, "How many you got, son? Just give me all of them."
You know, one of the funniest things I think I heard J.D. do one night, we were at the Ryman Auditorium and Wally Fowler's all night singing. And it was probably in the mid-50s. The Spear family was there. And James Blackwood and the Blackwoods, and Hovey and the Statesman. And just as about to close, Brock happened to be the last one out to close, and he was going to dismiss in prayer. And he said, "Now, if the Lord don't come, we'll see all of you here next first Friday night, if the Lord don't come." And J.D. stuck his head around the curtain. He says, "Well, don't worry about it. Said James and Hovey will be there anyhow."
You know, J.D. was really fast. Gloria had him and Mark Lowry up at her store. We have a new store there in Alexandria. For a night, these are special nights that she has an artist, and we were in our studio. I had about 300 people there, and they were telling stories, and Mark was acting up, and J.D. was telling his thing. And our little, how old was he, 3 years old, honey? About 3 year old grandson thought he could run wild because he's, you know, he's used to doing that, I guess. He's running back and forth and back and forth while J.D. was talking. And I kept thinking on my breath, "For crying out loud, Gloria, do something about getting Jess," because I knew it was aggravating J.D. J.D. kept trying to talk, and Jess was having a big old time running back to the front of the studio, back the other way, and Gloria couldn't get him stopped. And so finally J.D. turned around and said, "Would somebody get that kid and sit him in a seat?" And somebody sitting in the front row said, "Hey, you better be careful. That's Gloria's grandson." He said, "Oh, he is. What a lovely child." I said, he was fast. I think for all of our sakes, one more time, we need to watch the clip. The famous clip of J.D. and the organ player. Roll the clip and we'll watch it one more time.
Morning, word not to have an organ in my funeral.
And he would have been happy. There was no organ at his funeral. There was a lot of joy. There's a lot of fact. In fact, Larry and I yesterday were talking about this, and we said, wouldn't it be great to write a little course? We only got a little course, and about the funeral, about the fact that there was an organ at the funeral. Larry, can you lead him?
There was singing, there was laughter, there were smiles and there were tears. Friends of his were singing pretty words. But even up in heaven, J.D. was still in charge. Not a sound of an organ could be heard.
I gotta tell one more story.
Yeah.
It won't take long. I was a little kid. They were working in Lubbock. Blackwoods were there. And it was they were on the first tour that they'd ever had those new speakers and the stands, those metal things. They put them way up high, you know, those big old Voice of the Theaters. Well, somehow, like I said, it was the first week or two they'd had those speakers. J.D. mashed his finger real bad. Had it wrapped up in a bunch of gauze and tape and stuff, putting those speakers up. So they got out there in the middle of the concert, and they got in the middle of a song, and J.D. said, "Hold it, James. I want to talk to these people just a minute." He said, "Folks, I want y'all to know something. If I get in the middle of one of these songs and raise my hand up, it ain't because I'm praising God. I'm just trying to get the blood to run out of my sore finger."
And we're going to miss Mark. Had a wonderful experience in the last 3 years of his life getting acquainted with him. And in talking to him one time, J.D. got a prisoner out of prison early so he could be home with his wife and his family at Christmas. And it really thrilled J.D.'s heart just to know that that guy was going to be home with his wife and his kids. Mark was quite curious and asked J.D., he said, "What did he do?" J.D. said, "What do you mean?" "I mean, what did he do to go to prison?" And without hardly missing a beat, right, Mark? J.D. said, "Why does it make any difference?" And I think it says something about J.D. and what happened in the last years of his life. We did a special video on his life, and he wanted to sing this song. He wanted to make this statement. I want you all to watch it as he sings this special song, okay?
I've never been one, y'all know me, I've never been one to get on stage and what you call testify. I always said my brother does the preaching and my sisters do the testifying, and I was the singer of the family. But this is my testimony. Man, this was written especially for me. And just listen to the words, and this is J.D. Sumner, if I hope I can sing it. And I want to dedicate it to my brother, Buddy. God still lives in this old house. If this earthly tabernacle would be dissolved today, I'd trade it for a finer one that would not pass away. But till the day arrives when it's time for moving out. It's such sweet peace to know the Lord still lives in this old house. The sweetest fellowship I've known has fortified these walls, and peace has reigned since he's been walking up and down these halls. There's snow upon the rooftop now, and these hinges are near worn out. It's such sweet peace to know the Lord still lives in this old house. To him it's been a dwelling place where he kept my hand in his. It's home, away from home is all that it really is, and it sure ain't fine and fancy, and all I can boast about is after all the years the Lord still in this old house. There were times when he had the right just to up and move away, and there were times and days I knew it took amazing grace to stay. That's why I can sing and shout. It's such sweet peace to know the Lord still lives in this old house. Dwelling place where he kept my hand in his. To me it's home, away from home is all that it really is, and it sure ain't fun and fancy, and all I can boast about is after all the years the Lord still lives in this old house.
After all these years the Lord
still lives in this old house.
So Howard and Vestal and Les and George, Rex and Hovey, Jake and Naomi, and many more of you, you're very, very important to us. And we love you, and we honor you. And we want you to stick around as long as we can get you to stick around.